human immunodeficiency virus is not, in the strictest sense, a form of life. Until it is inside a host body, it is no more alive than a rock or a stone. It is a protein-coated mass of genetic instructions, 150 times smaller than the white blood cell it attacks. After penetrating, it multiplies until the cell bursts and dies. This continues for years. Cell by cell, the virus destroys its carrier's immune system. The person becomes ill from a series of infections that are progressively serious and rare, and finally fatal. This is AIDS.
Quarterly, people so desperate they go outside the law to search for cures.
Now, it's not a simple treatment, and it's not a safe treatment, and the odds are very good someone's going to die of this treatment.
And AIDS education, money, and morals.
You and I both know what they were going to do. They were going to have an orgy. They were going to have a homosexual orgy with state funds.
Funding for the AIDS Quarterly is provided by a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Resources making a difference in the health care of Americans.
Good evening. I'm Peter Jennings, and this is the winter edition of the AIDS Quarterly. In tonight's program, we're going to take a hard look at two powerful government agencies and the ways in which they have acted or not acted in the face of the AIDS crisis. The FDA is the institution that we all rely on to ensure the safety of the food and drugs we use. The law says it must certify that all drugs are safe before they are released to the public. But many people who have AIDS are not prepared to wait. They have nothing to lose, they argue, by taking experimental drugs, which the FDA has not approved. This is the story of desperate and defiant people who have challenged the way new drugs are tested by taking matters into their own hands. The trial of Compound Q.
San Francisco, May the 23rd, 1989.
What I have in here is the envelope for each of you containing the tricoxanthin that's come from China. Project Inform is not the supplier of this, but I am acting as the courier to get it to you guys from the people who brought it into the country. You're not going to be charged.
An AIDS activist distributed a new experimental drug. He did so outside the doctor's office to get around the law that prohibits a doctor from supplying a drug to these men for a clinical trial.
This is not an FDA-approved clinical trial. The protocol did not go to FDA in advance. It was not approved by traditional institutional review boards.
Martin Delaney is one of the most influential AIDS activists in the country. For years, he's been challenging the Food and Drug Administration to speed up its drug trial procedures.
But I think it's been shown time and again in AIDS, when you've got a crisis, a national emergency going on, you have to take a shorter path to your goal.
For years, activists have been demanding that the agency loosen up its regulations and allow access to experimental drugs, anything that might prolong life. One of the drugs they wanted was this one, tricoxanthin, better known as Compound Q, a Chinese abortion and cancer drug. It was tantalizing because it killed HIV-infected cells in the test tube. The FDA promised human trials. But for activists like Martin Delaney, trials administered by the FDA would take too long. So Delaney joined forces with Dr. Alan Levin, a San Francisco immunologist who was prepared to conduct an accelerated trial, illegally.
Now, it's not a simple treatment, and it's not a safe treatment, and the odds are very good someone's going to die of this treatment. I mean, we're not kidding ourselves. This is not just a magical panacea.
Dr. Levin was prepared to put his reputation on the line because many people had imported it from China and were taking unsupervised doses.
Levin asked for volunteers from among his own patients. He and his staff chose three who had advanced cases of AIDS.
Do you understand that Dr. Levin does not guarantee that tricoxanthin treatment will slow down or stop your AIDS?
Yes, I do.
One of them, 41-year-old Tandy Ballou.
Do you understand as well that this is not necessarily a cure for AIDS?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm in my seventh year of dealing with this, and I'm tired of all the symptoms, and I'm willing to try, you know, I'm willing to take the risk to wipe it out completely.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, my main hope is that it is going to eliminate the virus completely, and I really believe it is. In terms of hopes for myself, I'm a survivor. I feel like that now. And if it doesn't work for me, that's not the end of the road for me. But I think it may be for a lot of people. So many people are counting on this drug.
Day one. The patients received their first infusions of Compound Q. The trial consisted of three doses over 3 weeks.
I can tell you that we're going to see benefit or lack of benefit in hours, certainly in days.
Dr. Levin was looking for an increase in T4 cells, the white blood cells that fight disease. He was worried about side effects. He was most concerned about MTD, the maximum tolerated dose. That signals when the drug is about to overpower the body. Besides Tandy Ballou, the other patients were 39-year-old Norman Watkins and 41-year-old Ron Fisher.
We needed people who had tried previous therapies and who had failed those previous therapies.
Dr. Larry Waits assisted Dr. Levin.
They have tried virtually everything, and everything is failing them, and they are at the point now where they are trying this as literally it is their last resort.
They waited anxiously for the drug to take effect.
I was thinking about so many of my friends that have died. And I felt their presence.
And I just thought of all the people who have been so good to me in my life. That was the main thing in my life. Closing my eyes and seeing these wonderful people who have been so kind to me and so nice and so caring through this whole thing. And kind of a determination.
I'm going to survive this and get over it. I am committed to it. I believe that I'm going to survive it and get over it.
They were kept overnight for observation. The activist and the doctor were anxious, too.
Let's say the drug worked. Let's say it nearly knocked out all these infected cells. Would the immune system recover?
I'm going to speculate. The guys with high suppressor cells will respond because they have a lot of bone marrow reserves. The guy with low total T cells and low suppressor cells might have more trouble. My sense is the guys whose bone marrows have been damaged by AZT won't do as well as the guys whose bone marrows haven't been damaged by AZT. I'm speculating again that there's going to be a dramatically clear result one way or the other.
Yeah.
Hope you're right. And I'm also speculating we're going to run into some big trouble with some guys.
The next morning, the first set of results were encouraging.
We got 146. Now, in the main, everybody did very well. And the one patient that we have the data on right now, we see about a 35% increase in the white blood cells in 12 hours. That's pretty impressive. Medically, scientifically, and ethically, it should be made available to every HIV-positive person in this country by the end of the year, if it works. And we'll know that within 6 weeks to a month, 2 months.
A very accelerated trial. Across town at San Francisco General Hospital, Compound Q was undergoing an official FDA trial, and it would take at least 18 months under the direction of Dr. Paul Wolberding.
Even though there was some prior experience with this type of drug in China, there wasn't any experience that any of us had any direct involvement with, and we expected that the drug would be more toxic in the setting of AIDS. So when we designed the initial trials, we said we don't really know what dose to use. We don't know what side effects to expect, so we'll do a very careful study. It's called a dose escalating study, where we start out with very low doses of the drug and build up as we get more comfortable with the drug.
Patients in Dr. Volberding's trial initially received only a fraction of the dose that Dr. Levin was administering to his volunteers.
That's the traditional way that we've used new drugs for the first time in people. So the plan for this drug is really comparable to the plan for other drugs that we've used in the past.
Dr. Volberding did not know that the secret trial was taking place. On the seventh day of his trial, Dr. Levin was optimistic.
In every patient, we've seen at least a doubling, if not a tripling, of the white blood cell count. And these people have run very low white blood cell counts for years, or for at least the year that we've been tracking them. So something very dramatic is happening to them. There are a lot of questions as to whether to double the dose next time or even to increase it by 10%. We just don't know. So right now, to be on the safe side, we're just going to expand the population at this level, dose level, and monitor them.
So the next day, Norman, Tandy, and Ron received their second infusion, the same amount as the first time.
And that makes sense first couple of days anyway, doesn't it?
Yeah.
While four new volunteers began in the trial.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's still
5:30.
How when is that? So that's a week later.
Yeah.
And still, it got a white count.
More than
a normal range.
Almost
that's
twice
remarkable.
The white count.
On the eighth day, the experiment took a turn for the worse. After his second infusion, Tandy's mental capacity was seriously impaired.
I'm scared. Very, very much scared right now. I've been here all day since, 8:30, 9:30, something like that. And the doctor wanted to see what's happening with me. Gave me some medications, and doesn't really see much difference. Still difficult. And it's scary. You know, I'm pretty scared by all this.
Well, Tandy, as you saw, had an episode where he has a lot of confusion, and he has difficulty gathering words, and has organic brain syndrome. And of course, most of our guys have described some level of feeling confused and inability to think well. He happens to be the worst. He's had the worst reactions in of any of the guys regards his problems with the drugs.
At this point, Dr. Levin speculated that compound Q might be killing brain cells, leading to temporary dementia or even coma. Then Levin's assistant, Clark Huseman, learned that Norm was also ill. The drug was taking over his body. It appeared they had reached maximum tolerated dose, MTD.
Norm is due to come in today anyway for blood work to be checked. And a friend is saying just how ill he is and how difficult it is for him to get around. And he's expected to be in here anyway today. So that's what the telephone was conversation was about. He has to come in. We have to check him out. And if he can't walk, he has trouble walking anyway, even before this started. We have to get him in by ambulance.
A worried Dr. Levin made a decision.
Well, that's MTD, friend. I mean, I'm not going any further with anybody.
So what does this mean for Thursday group? It's too soon to say right now.
You mean in terms of the second infusion?
Second infusion?
No second infusion on anybody as far as I'm concerned.
At this point,
right, yeah. Hello?
Hi, I'm sorry. Can you take a call from Martin Delaney on 65?
Okay. Hi, Marty. We're hitting the wall. Well, Tandy has marked changes which are chronic. You know, he's got atrophy and dirty white matter. And, he's got AIDS dementia. Yeah, in his case, we have to wait and watch. Norm Watkins is in here with a temperature of 103.2, which is coming down. Yeah, the problem with him is we don't know what antibiotic to use because he's been on all of them. I really don't like hurting people. But, you know, obviously these guys had no alternatives, and so I just don't want to be the one that accelerates their demise, huh? But, you know, we might be able to pull them through. Who knows?
Hours later, Levin wanted to cancel the trial. Delaney wanted to proceed. They argued.
Next question, though, is do we do a second infusion on the second group?
Yeah. Well, see, on that one, I'm more inclined to think yes, but maybe rethinking the dosage question. I know some of those guys are very upset at the thought of not doing it, too.
But they're so sick.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe what about making some individual choices, then?
Well,
letting them call it. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's sort of their calling it anyway, so what would be the difference here?
Because I'd feel guilty if I heard them no matter what they said.
Yeah. See, there's nothing in any of the lab work I've seen right now that suggests a problem with anybody. I mean, the only stuff in the lab work suggests some fairly significant benefits, in fact. Now, it's too early to make any kind of conclusion from that, but I don't see any evidence of harm in any blood work, do you?
I just see the evidence of harm walking through the door.
Right.
By this point, the trial was no longer a secret. Word had leaked to the FDA. But the agency did not intervene. Former FDA official William Vodra.
10 years ago, the FDA might have been more inclined to say, we're going to bring enforcement action against you to stop you from doing this research without prior approval of the FDA.
The FDA has a long history of changing policy. It was created in 1938 by President Roosevelt after a patent medicine killed 107 people. It was the polio epidemic that first pushed the government to an all-out effort, bending its own rules to develop a vaccine. Then thalidomide, the drug that caused terrible birth defects.
Of the wonder drugs that went wrong.
So President Kennedy stiffened its regulations and made it harder to get drugs approved. These same rules were in effect in the early 1980s. Drugs had to be proven not just safe, but also effective. A cautious approach that seemed to work for most drugs. But the agency was unprepared to deal with the sudden onslaught of the AIDS epidemic and the highly politicized gay community.
The FDA, I think, is intimidated by the AIDS community. The AIDS activists have sat in at FDA headquarters, occupied the desks and so forth. They've assaulted the FDA's integrity and honor. And I think the FDA, frankly, is on the defensive. It's not been able to articulate and defend well its own position about what the law requires and why the law requires it and why that's in the public interest.
By the end of the second week, Norman was unable to leave home and come for a checkup. Compound Q had apparently further weakened his immune system. Dr. Levin went to him.
All three of us got sore and tired and fatigued. And I've had trouble with fever for 2 years, so I don't know if it's from another infection or from the drug itself. But this has been a bad week. So if I die, I was going to die anyway. Probably. It's hard. It's hard.
Tandy's condition was troubling.
And it's doing okay for a while, and then just completely lost it. Completely lost my mental capacity. Very, very out of it. Very much out of it.
Well, this comes back to the question that always comes up with these, and that is, do you treat the very sick people who desperately want to get treated because they feel they have to, or do you try to treat people at an earlier stage of the disease?
Well, this is the nature of the phase one trial, right? I mean, that's what you do in the first place. Establish MTD on the basis of the sicker patients.
Mm-hmm. But so often, they're the wrong patients to try treating.
I
mean,
that's
the history of this disease has been that every drug that's come along, it's worked better at earlier stages rather than later.
Then both Tandy and Norman stopped taking Compound Q. For the next 2 months, the trial continued with healthier patients. Altogether, 19 men were taking Compound Q. Then in late June, Ron Fisher died of pulmonary cancer. Days later, another patient died, and suddenly the news was everywhere.
the secret that had been debated only behind the closed doors of the FDA was suddenly very public.
Well, I think, first of all, the Project Informed Study is playing more than a passive role. They're encouraging, by being involved, patients to use drugs out of desperation that haven't been tested for safety.
We face a situation here that has been typical throughout the AIDS epidemic, in that patients are gearing up for large-scale importation and distribution and use of this drug because it appears to be so promising.
6 weeks later, the FDA, which had known of the trial almost from the beginning, felt obliged to respond. It sent a letter to Martin Delaney.
The letter was basically told Mr. Delaney that, you know, we certainly did not approve of the protocol, that it was illegal.
But the letter had a curious turn of phrase. Although it said, "We feel that you should discontinue any further unapproved experimentation," it closed with, "We look forward to working with you." An unprecedented invitation to an AIDS activist.
I never expected FDA to, you know, to come down on us and lock us up. I think they understood the good faith and intentions and what we were doing, and that once they had the opportunity to look at how we did it, I think they could understand that we were scientifically responsible as well.
The AIDS drugs are treated in a wholly separate category, and the FDA is developing separate rules for those drugs. The long-term question is to what extent, when they get those rules in place, those rules will become the rules for drugs for arthritis and ulcers and diabetes and asthma and so forth.
By the fall, Dr. Levin had assessed his findings from the trial and claimed that the drug might keep the AIDS virus from reproducing. And so he thought his experiments were justified.
I've got to tell you that the obligation between a doctor and a patient is above any law of any land, period. And if the Nazis say throw this Jew in an oven, as a doctor, I would be obligated to say no. And I don't care what any regulatory affairs, any governmental institution tells me, if this is going to save a life, I'm going to do it. And I'll tell you, I'll do everything that's scientifically, medically, and morally correct, and somebody else has to make it legal.
But by the end of the year, it was clear that Compound Q was not the miracle cure. Norman Watkins died of complications from AIDS. Compound Q may have contributed to his death. By then, one of the patients in the San Francisco General trial had died as well. Dr. Volberding had a different view of Dr. Levin's efforts.
We felt quite strongly that this was not a good idea to do this kind of a study in a non-academic setting without the review, the external review of institutional review boards, the FDA, and a drug company sponsor. And I still feel that that's true. I think what's changed probably is that we appreciate again that our goals are the same, and that we've learned too over time that we really do have to look at our way of approaching things to make sure that we're not slowing things down. It's not fair for us to criticize someone else if, in fact, we are part of the problem.
Tandy, you want
to? But he also had some good news. Tandy Ballou had rallied.
I actually thought I was dying. I woke up one morning and I said to myself, "Tandy, this isn't working. I think you're dying. Stop your medications. Stop everything right now." So I did. I stopped it all. And in 2 days' time, I knew I was coming back.
In December, Tandy began taking Compound Q again.
I was disappointed when it wasn't like the miracle cure right away. It wasn't the magic bullet. But continued with it, and I think it's working. I see other friends of mine that are doing quite well on it.
So is Compound Q effective against AIDS? There are still no clear answers. The official FDA trial isn't over yet. Martin Delaney and the FDA are working together now. Delaney is planning yet another study of Compound Q, but this time with official approval. We'll be right back. When last broadcast in September, there have been some news developments. The number of AIDS cases in the United States has increased during the past 4 months, from 100,000 to nearly 120,000. Around the globe, the World Health Organization says there are now over 600,000 cases, and by the year 2000, they say that number will increase tenfold. That's 6 million cases of AIDS. In the continuing effort to develop a vaccine that will actually prevent people from getting AIDS, several research teams have now created vaccines that work in monkeys. Scientists, however, say we are still several years away from a vaccine that works in humans. And lest there be any doubt as to where AIDS is affecting Americans, the number of AIDS cases is up in every group. Up among gays, up among intravenous drug users, and up among heterosexuals as well. No vaccine, rising numbers. It means this. The real weapon against AIDS is still education. In the last 5 years, the federal government has spent more than $1 billion on AIDS education. Because AIDS is still increasing, we wondered seriously whether AIDS education was working anywhere. What we found was a tangle of money and morals. From 1985 to 90, nearly $1 billion in federal money spent on AIDS education. Since the middle of the Reagan administration, the tug of war over how to spend it has been a mighty one. Many of the gay groups involved in AIDS education said they needed the money to produce explicit material which would be readily and widely understood by gay men. The Reagan administration saw education as a way to make a moral statement.
We felt that on this particular controversy, that public health advice happened to correspond with good moral advice. I mean, the best public health advice was to refrain from having numerous sexual partners, monogamy, etc.
Bauer spelled out the president's moral agenda in a letter to the Secretary of Health and Human Services. The resources we have to fight AIDS must not be used to promote homosexual activities, which many Americans find deeply offensive. The president's position was reinforced by the Attorney General and the Secretary of Education. He sent brochures on AIDS to every private and public school in the country. The administration's idea of explicit AIDS education was to emphasize marriage and monogamy. The administration and AIDS activists might as well have been on separate planets. Congressman William Dannemeyer of California was the most outspoken opponent in Congress of how the activist groups were spending the federal AIDS money.
When you really call them up in these AIDS care centers, you find out what they're really doing is propagandizing the homosexual lifestyle, laughing all the way to the bank in the fact that they've conned the system into getting all these federal tax dollars ostensibly to fight AIDS.
For 7 years, Ronald Reagan never talked publicly about AIDS. This failure to address a major health problem led to enormous resentment in the gay community. With no cure in sight and with thousands of men dying from AIDS, gay activists stepped up their education campaign.
We have to keep in mind at that time we had literally no medical interventions to stop the spread of AIDS. So our only weapon, our only proven therapy, was education.
The first educational material from the gay men's health crisis in New York, produced with only a smattering of federal money, did not make any waves.
And we were coming up with the models, we were developing and we were designing them. And they were graphic, and they were explicit, and they worked.
But when Congressman Dannemeyer passed a copy of this videotape to his congressional colleagues, any more direct federal money for gay activists went out the window.
We presented to the House the explicit material produced by the Gay Men's Health Crisis Center in New York City, with federal tax dollars, by the way. Some of the trash, the pornographic trash, that was produced, that was designed ostensibly in the guise of education to prevent people from acquiring this disease. It was a joke.
These are materials that are meant for a targeted audiences. They're meant for people who are in gay bars and gay bookstores and gay bathhouses. That's who they're meant to reach. And yes, it's graphic. And the reason it's graphic is we found people changed their behavior much more and sustained that behavioral change when they looked at graphic, explicit material. So we were simply doing what we thought was the right thing, which is what was good for the public health.
The president, there were a few things that would get his Irish dander up faster than this kind of an issue. When he saw money being spent for things that I think legitimately could be described as being pornographic, that he just thought was an outrage, and he made that very clear in cabinet meetings.
The gay men's health crisis also produced what it called safe sex comics. When they came to the attention of North Carolina Senator Jesse Helms, he used them on the floor of the Senate to support his amendment against any federal funds being used to encourage homosexual activities.
Comic books do not encourage a change in that perverted sexual behavior. In fact, the comic book promotes sodomy and the homosexual lifestyle as an acceptable alternative in American society. And Mr. President, I dissent.
Well, again, this was an attempt to impose ideology over the efforts to protect the public health. And it was a demagogic effort, and I'm sorry to say that to an extent it succeeded.
The amendment passed 94-2. The White House, Dannemeyer, and Helms had won. AIDS education money would no longer go directly from Congress to any gay activists. Now it would go to the Centers for Disease Control, which in turn would direct it to the state health departments. At the CDC, there were no serious discussions about money which were not influenced by the administration's moral position. Dr. Sam Thompson was the CDC's senior medical consultant in 1985, 86, and 87.
There were meetings that you could go to at fairly high levels where you were asked not to use the word condom in so-and-so's presence. Because that was implied other things than birth control. It implied sexuality. Basically, that people might be having sex and that it wasn't just for reproduction.
It is in this climate that the CDC is distributing hundreds of millions of dollars for AIDS education. While a tiny amount goes directly to some minority groups, most of the money goes to the states. And as we discovered in three quite different states, AIDS education is whatever those in charge of the money in the states decide it is. AIDS is hitting Florida hard. Miami has the seventh highest rate of AIDS in the country. There is no indication that safe sex education is working. Miami has one of the highest rates of heterosexual transmission. In the diverse neighborhoods of the city, AIDS education is proving a complex and difficult task. This woman discovered she had AIDS when her baby was born. She doesn't know how she got it.
I took every precaution even before it came out, and then when they told me I had it, I couldn't believe it. You know, I'm not promiscuous.
She is middle class, non-drug using, heterosexual. Education should have reached her.
They're only giving out part the idea, and I think the American people should know the whole story, of the suspicion of AIDS, you know, because I wondered, I said, oh, it had to come from the meat. You know, maybe my steak was too raw, or my roast beef wasn't cooked enough, you know, I thought maybe someone was messing with the meat, you know.
Across from the police station in central Miami are the people who spend Florida's federal education dollars.
They will all disseminate educational materials.
But it might be helpful to send them through the district AIDS coordinator, let him initial off on it.
The state of Florida gets $10 million for AIDS education from the Centers for Disease Control. About $1 million of that goes to Miami.
A monitoring
memo do you want from us?
After most of it has been used for salaries, this is what they do with the rest. They are proud of these posters and the condom coupons. You send in the coupon, and the state sends you 25 condoms. The Health Department's Education Director in Miami, Bonnie Bailey.
Your biggest success?
Film Fest for Life, in conjunction with Mexican Independence Day.
Bailey says the state spent $200 on posters and a booth at this neighborhood Mexican Independence Festival.
Provide AIDS education, but more of a soft sell approach, having a tent, lots of information, being part of a float.
The intention here is to be available, but not aggressive. A much different strategy from that of Miami's most aggressive AIDS educator. Cure AIDS Now uses food to get into the neighborhoods to start a dialogue and spread the word about AIDS. This group doesn't get any money from the federal government.
We've put out 130,000 meals to nearly 1,000 clients. We've raised $1,300,000 to deliver food and keep people alive and bring the hope and deal with all the 1,001 crises they're going through. You think we get a dime from the government to deal on this level? Nothing from the health department, nothing from the Centers for Disease Control.
Bob Kuntz is executive director of Cure AIDS Now. His partner is Marlene Arribas.
We have been fighting for 3 years to try to get funding so we can put more staff together. There's no case management. Our drivers are the case managers.
What is the
case? Our drivers that deliver food have to come in and tell us this one died, this one moved, this one canceled.
Here is a classic example of AIDS activists who believe that AIDS education must be aggressive. You must go to AIDS before AIDS comes to you.
Here we're delivering food in the crack houses. The food is a door opener to trust. We're able to talk to people, deal on a completely different level, and we're begging for the help and support because we're all burnt out.
If your eyes are going, if you're going blind in one eye, you got to get treatment for it. Did you tell them anything at the hospital about your eyes?
No, it's just odds and wonders.
Just start doing that. You want me to call a taxi so that they can come and get you and take you over there? All right, when is your next appointment?
We have to deal with the suicides and everybody else. That doesn't go to HRS. These are the biggest phonies that ever happened.
Well, tell them the real reason why we don't get funded by HRS.
Because we have been yelling and screaming on the fact that they're playing politics with the public's health.
Bob Kuntz says they'll apply again next year. But the competition for CDC money is fierce.
The local community-based organizations are fighting for basically the same funding sources. And I think that that of course if we could provide them more, they would be happier. You know, we provide them with what we can.
But here's the record. Other than a tiny amount Congress has told the CDC must be given to some minority groups, none of Miami's federal money is shared with community groups. And that is how AIDS education goes in a state with the third highest rate of AIDS infection in the nation. They have a whole different view of what AIDS education should mean in Colorado.
We're going into a security area now, and I have to stand in front of here so you can't see the code. We will change it as soon as you leave.
This is where Colorado keeps the names and addresses of the people it knows carry the AIDS virus. Colorado interprets AIDS education and prevention as testing, tracking down, and keeping files.
This is within a separate security perimeter. This is where all the records are kept, okay? This room is manned at all times when we're open for business. When we're not open for business, then we set the alarm. It has motion detectors, heat detectors, sound detectors, that sort of thing.
This is how Colorado spends most of its $2.5 million in federal money.
These people do all STD and AIDS surveillance.
This is the most controversial AIDS education and prevention program anywhere in the country.
This is still operations and development here.
Not only does Colorado keep tabs on people with the AIDS virus, but the state aggressively seeks out those people's sex or drug-using partners.
They find people who've been exposed and get those people in for treatment or testing.
The state approaches the fight against AIDS for which there is no cure, in the same way it has always dealt with gonorrhea and syphilis, for which there is.
And indeed, that's the basis from which we started, the application of known, successful public health methods to the control of this epidemic.
Hi.
I'd have an HIV test.
Here's how it works. First, the state encourages people to take an AIDS test. And if the test is positive, the state keeps the results on file and also tries to track down past sex partners or those who may have shared needles.
Okay, my name's Stuart. Everything we talk about will be confidential.
The patient is entitled to use a false name and address.
And have you lived in Colorado?
But the state does want the real names of his sexual partners.
Do you have sex with men, women, or both?
Men.
When was your last unsafe sex with a man?
I guess that would have been November of last year.
Okay. There was no oral or anal without a condom, even short of the orgasm?
Well, there was oral where I was in the top position.
Okay. Okay, so he would, okay.
The state hires Saul Johnson to hunt for people who have been exposed to the AIDS virus. And once he finds them, he tries to test them, often taking a blood sample in his car. If they test positive, their names will go on the state records.
You just never know what a person's response is going to be. That's one of the things about the job that gets your adrenaline pumping, because when you go up to that door, knock on the door, you just never know how someone is going to respond.
Colorado gay groups say this tracing and tracking scares people away from testing. Ann Shields of the Colorado AIDS Project.
If you give a false name in Colorado, it's important that you give a false address and a false phone number as well, because we do know that the health department is cross-referencing the address to see if they can pick up the right name somehow.
Oftentimes people will say, well, I knew someone like you was going to be coming to talk to me. I knew it all the time.
But not everyone wants to be found. In 6 months in 1988, the state spent $450,000 of CDC funds looking for people who had been exposed. They found 52.
The CDC has not written me an official letter saying that, but I will tell you that the support that we get from private commentary, from people whom I respect, and I'm talking about leadership, has been strong.
A block away from Colorado's capital, the state's largest gay AIDS group, the Colorado AIDS Project.
I think some of the gay outreach that we do here is not understood and, well, I should say baptized by CDC as a viable option that's valued because the population isn't valued.
At a gay bar in Denver, the Colorado AIDS Project takes a much different approach to AIDS education and prevention.
You might be coming back soon.
80% of AIDS cases here are gay males, and AIDS is on the rise again in the gay population. So the emphasis here is not testing and tracking, but on passing out condoms and advice.
They give you a card, and card for each of you. There's rules of the roads for safe sex on the back, and a phone number on the front that you can refer your questions to, all right?
Do you have your condoms on you?
I keep them at home.
You keep them at home? In the nearest nightstand, right?
None of the $2.5 million in federal money available to the state of Colorado is shared with the Colorado AIDS Project. Fred Wolf runs the state of Colorado's AIDS office.
Why hasn't Colorado AIDS Project been funded?
For the proposals that they've submitted, they just haven't made it through the technical review process. They just weren't good enough. Quite frankly.
But doesn't it seem strange to you that they aren't getting any from this office?
Well, it does. Sure. But the problem is that you have to come up with a good idea and you have to be able to develop a proposal that's defensible.
I think part of its ownership, you know, in other groups, certainly the health department saying this belongs to us, we need to own this. And almost an embarrassment, maybe, of feeling that if they don't own it, there's something wrong, rather than being able to parcel it out to the groups that can do it most effectively.
And so in Colorado, there is an impasse. The government and AIDS activists disagree on how money for AIDS education and prevention should be spent. And the government has the money. There is no state in the union immune from the increase in AIDS, including Senator Helms' home state of North Carolina. The Reverend Joseph Chambers, whose church is just outside Charlotte, is a powerful force in setting the moral and political tone of the AIDS debate.
There is a strong homosexual lobby in this nation that have put out great efforts and great intensity to hide the fact that that AIDS arose because of radical sexual activity, especially radical homosexual activity.
Now, as part of his anti-gay campaign, Joseph Chambers picked up on an educational effort by a local gay group, which was funded in part with federal money. This wallet-sized card was designed for distribution in gay bars, deliberately designed, say gays, to get attention. The card invites someone to suggest what sort of sex they like. Safe sex. Chambers sent it to his friend the governor. In the state capital, Raleigh, the Secretary of Human Resources, David Flaherty, got the card.
And what it said, hello, my name is, and you put your name in there, and then it listed about 40 different sex acts. And if you were interested in any of them, you call that person. To me, that was a terrible waste of taxpayers' money.
The group that made the card, Metrolina in Charlotte, explains why the card was so explicit.
We feel that you needed those strong messages. You needed something that attracted the eye, something that they would say, I'm going to pick this up. This looks interesting.
In Raleigh, Mr. Flaherty found it interesting enough to take a hard look at various AIDS education proposals his office had approved.
I can't remember all of them, but one was a Tupperware party where they were to teach safe sex.
You and I both know what they were going to do. They were going to have an orgy. They were going to have a homosexual orgy with state funds, with my tax dollars.
I started figuring it out when I started going to meetings of the State AIDS Task Force.
David Jones of the North Carolina AIDS Services Coalition.
There is clearly a political supervision of public health in North Carolina. No question about it. And it comes from Washington. It comes from Senator Helms' office. And that has permeated not only the policies but the attitudes of people in government who are dealing with AIDS and trying to deal with AIDS.
North Carolina gets $2 million from the Centers for Disease Control. A small portion goes to gay groups, and a smaller portion to anyone helping educate blacks. 48% of the people with AIDS in North Carolina are black. Fred McCree got some of the money. He is a one-man, community-based organization. He gets in his car and tries to bring the AIDS message to blacks in six rural counties.
If you have sex with someone new after you've left one arrangement, you run a serious risk because you're sleeping with anyone that person has slept with, say, for the last 10 years.
McCree works long hours alone on the road. He keeps his overhead low. It's a good thing he does.
What's your bottom line financially?
I think that when you cut it down, including my transportation, I think that your first year's contract came to about $11,500.
$11,500?
Yeah, and that's what I said. Now,
for a year?
Yes, I told you I worked for McDonald's, you know, for McDonald's money. They don't have the grace to say this is obscene.
In 1988, because of the Safe Sex Card and the Safe Sex Parties, the state of North Carolina canceled the grants for every single proposal from community-based organizations.
We took a year off and gave AIDS a head start. We gave AIDS a year's break in this state. The real tragedy is people are going to die because of this.
What we have seen in North Carolina, Florida, and Colorado are not exceptions to the way federal AIDS education money is politically manipulated.
There has been, I think, from at least the central leadership at CDC, kind of a sellout that this is a such a politically hot topic that we're going to bow to the pressures of what Washington wants. And I think AIDS just absolutely epitomized, to my way of thinking, CDC caving in to what was happening up in Washington.
The director of the CDC's AIDS office believes the money is properly controlled.
The CDC is very concerned about how the dollars that Congress gives us are spent by the governments or agencies that receive the money from CDC. And we have a system of closely monitoring how that's spent.
On Capitol Hill, the CDC AIDS office is getting a bad reputation. When the General Accounting Office finished its analysis, it said that the CDC effort was plagued by staffing shortages, lack of expertise, and an irregular flow of funds. $1 billion for AIDS education and prevention between 1985 and 1990.
The religious zealots, right-wing zealots in the Reagan administration thought they had a wonderful opportunity with this AIDS epidemic. They've sort of shifted it all over to the states, for the most part, in a few cases, the city health people, to do whatever they want with the money. And the federal government doesn't even know how that money's being spent.
Across the country, AIDS activists are waiting to hear whether it will be any different under President Bush. The president's senior health advisor in the White House is Dr. William Roper.
Without taking away from the importance of AIDS as an issue, I guess I'd say to you, in the year that I've been here, we've not had a lot of discussions about AIDS.
Recently, Dr. Roper was named the new head of the Centers for Disease Control. Might the CDC distribute the money differently under him?
I think that the best way to funnel funds of that sort are from a federal agency, and the CDC is one of the best federal agencies we've got, to funnel the money to an appropriate state agency and depend on state governments to organize and deliver services in their states.
After 5 years and $1 billion spent on AIDS education and prevention, AIDS is still increasing among Americans. There is no cure for AIDS. There is no vaccine to prevent AIDS. As of now, there is only AIDS education. And that is this edition of the AIDS Quarterly. We're going to come back on the 3rd of April with a 90-minute special. The most popular rock star in Africa has AIDS. And this fall, he went back to his homeland to warn his countrymen about the scourge of AIDS. The Quarterly went with him. Thank you for joining us this time. I'm Peter Jennings. Good night.
Funding for the AIDS Quarterly is provided by a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Resources making a difference in the health care of Americans.
Stay with us now for the McNeil Air News Hour special coverage of the State of the Union Address and the Democrat Response. That's coming up next at 9 p.m. here on WETA Stereo 26.
Special arrangement with the AIDS Quarterly. Operators at the National AIDS Hotline are standing by to answer questions.